I'm gonna start. Okay, so good morning. Maybe in the last class I told that we are looking at the numericals. We are looking at the numericals for the steam turbines. Numericals. And the first problem we solved using the trigonometric principle, that is from the velocity triangle. Now, the same problem we will try to solve using graphical method. Okay. Graphical method. Okay, so to solve the same problem using the graphical method, we need a graph sheet. So I have written a graph sheet. So what you have to do is you have to take a graph sheet and you have to take a scale. So let the scale of maybe 1 centimeter is equal to 50 meters per second. Fine, 1 centimeter is 50 meters per second. And what and all the properties we have calculated? We have calculated the U. So the first thing is the U is found to be around 235.6 meters per second. If I convert 235.6 divided by 50, okay, 235.6 divided by 60, if I do that, I'll be getting that particular value. And you draw that horizontal line on your graph sheet. Okay, 235.6 divided by 50. So it is 4.7 centimeters. So if I take this particular thing, so 4.7 centimeters, if I take this as half a centimeter, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So roughly around 4.7 centimeters I have drawn. So this is my U, which is U is equal to 4.71 or 4.7. So the graphical method, if I use, I'll be getting approximate answer. You won't be very accurate. 4.71 centimeters. Okay. Now I know the alpha. Say alpha is given in the problem, which is 20 degrees. So if I call this as this point as A and this point as B, from A, I will take a 20 degree line. I will take a 20 degree line, and what is the value of V1? V1 I can find from my phi. So phi is 0.5. So U divided by phi, if I do 235.6 divided by this thing, if I do that, I'll be getting my V1 as 523.8. It is 524. So if I take it on a scale, it is around 10.45. So V1 is around 10.48, that is 10.5 centimeters. So I will take a 20 degree line from here and 10.5 centimeters. Okay, 10.5 centimeters. I will take 10.5 centimeters like this. Okay, so this is my V1 work. Alpha 1 is equal to 20 degrees. Okay. Now you mark the point, you call that as C. So V1 is 10.5 centimeters, I draw. Now you join B and C. You join B and C. Okay. That gives your VR1. You measure that. You measure that VR1. Okay. You measure that VR1 and multiply by 50. So you measure that VR1 and multiply by 50, if I do. So it is around, roughly around 5 centimeters. Roughly, if you take it in this VR1, I may get around 5 centimeters, 5.1 or something. 5.1 centimeters, something. If I convert it to your multiply by 50, 5 into, so if I do that, I am getting around 6 centimeters or 6.1. It's not 5, it is around 6 centimeters. 6.1 centimeter if I do. So roughly I'm getting, but maybe on the graph sheet if I do, you will get it exactly. So around 6 centimeters, 6 by 50. So 6 into 5, if I do that, roughly around 300. Maybe if you do the by using calculator, we got around 312, I remember. Yeah, 312 we got. So you'll be getting around 310 or something. So VR1 is equal to 6.1 centimeters. Multiply by 50, you'll be getting the VR1 as 310 meters per second. Now, you draw a vertical line here. Fine. And draw, close it over here. You close it. So AB, so you mark the point D. Okay. You measure from D to A. You measure this. This will be your VW1. So this is on the graph sheet. You measure that VW1. Okay. And multiply by this thing. So VW1, if I measure it, it is around 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, roughly around 9 centimeters. Roughly around 9 centimeters. 9.5 or 6, whatever it may be. So multiply by 50, 9 by 45, around 480 or 490 meters per second, we'll get it. Okay. Then you measure this angle. This angle, that is angle BBC. You measure that angle and write beta 1 is equal to. So you will get around 34 to 35 degrees. Use a protractor and measure it. So I got my inlet velocity triangle using graphical method. Now, what is my VR2? See, VR1 we calculated, which is 6.1 centimeter multiplied by 50. I got my VR1. Multiply by, so VR2 if you do. So it is 310 into 0.9. So if I do that, I get around 200. So 280 meters per second divided by 50. If I do, I get around 5.6 centimeters. So VR2 is equal to 5.6 centimeters. And what is my beta 2? So if my beta 1 is 34 degrees, beta 2 is equal to 34 minus 3. So roughly around 31 or 32, whatever we got theoretically. So from B, take 5.6 centimeters with 31 or 32 degrees. Draw a line like this. Draw a line like this. Somewhere. So this is my VR2. This is my beta. Okay, you mark that as D. You mark this as E. Join A and E. And that gives your V2. Now close the triangle with drawing a vertical line from E and horizontal line from A. And you call that as F. This gives your VW2, measure that. Okay, it's around maybe 1.5 centimeters or whatever it may be. And you measure this VF2 and you measure this alpha. You measure VF1 here. Yeah, VF1 can be measured. So each and everything, whatever we used, we calculated using trigonometric principles, using taking the either cos alpha or cos beta or sine beta or tan beta, whatever we did. The same thing can be done using graphical method. The only thing is, graphical method, we may get that you will be getting an approximate answer. So see, it is in theoretical, when you calculate, if you get around 310.5 meters per second, graphically you may get around 306 or 307 meters per second, something like that. So approximate testing, you'll be getting it, and this is graphical method also, if people can. So any one of the method. So if you feel that graphically I can do faster with practice, go with it. Or if you feel that I'm happy with my regular method, I know I'm good at trigonometry, so I can calculate all the values using my trigonometric principle, you can use that method. So both the method I have teached. Okay. Now, the same problem, suppose if it's a double stage, it's a multi-stage. In that case, what will happen? Maybe when I take up the multi-stage problem, I will show you how to go ahead. how to show, how to draw the triangle for the two stage, and the same thing can be done using the graphical method. This is about your graphical method. Same thing, you calculate delta VW and you measure VW1, multi so many centimeters, multiply by 50. VW2, so many centimeters, multiply by this thing. So if I do that, I am getting around VW1 is around roughly around 480 meters per second. VW2, I am getting roughly around say 10 or whatever it may be meters per second. You have to be very careful. If you do that, it may come to the scale. And F axial is, see, VF1, I need to find VF1. So I'm getting around 160 or 170 meters per second, and VF2 around 150 meters per second. Just difference of 170 minus 150, multiply by mass flow rate, I'll get my axial force. So if I calculate the power, so power is actually mass flow rate into your delta VW into U. If you do that, I'm getting around 680, roughly around 680 to 670 kilowatts. So whatever you got the in theoretically using your calculator calculations, trigonometric principles, the same thing I can get it from the graphical methods. Same thing. Very close thing, you'll know how to get it. This is about the graphical method. That's fine. So shall we move to the next problem? Okay, fine. You just practice it. Even the next problem, what I'm going to do, even that problem also, you try to use the graphical method and try to solve it. Okay, we'll go to the next problem. Okay. The D-level steam turbine, it's not turbine, so the D-level steam turbine, received steam at a pressure of 10 bar, dry and saturated, okay, and exhaust at 1 bar. There are 4 nozzles, each of which are inclined at 20 degrees to the plane of the wheel. The average peripheral velocity of the blades are 450 meters per second. Calculate the blade angles for the blade. Assume that the inlet and outlet angles are the same. That is, this is a kind of unit outlet angle, beta 1 is equal to beta 2. That's the condition. So we have to find beta 1 and beta 2. So, and if the area of the throat at the nozzle is around 0.24 meter square, calculate the power developed by the turbine. Okay. Let's try to solve this problem. Solution. So let us write what is given. So the given is the inlet pressure, which is 10 bar, and the exit pressure. So this being a single stage, the exit pressure is P2, that is 1 bar. And there are M, so let me take the small m, that are 4 nozzles. Okay. And alpha 1 is 20 degrees, and your blade speed is around 450 meters per second. What you are supposed to find? To find beta 1 and beta 2. Okay. Let's write the HS diagram for this. Then we'll come to your velocity triangle. Let's write the HS diagram and try to understand the process. This is on a Mollier chart actually. HS diagram. And I do have a dome like this. Okay. And the constant pressure lines are going like this. Okay. The steam is dry saturated at the inlet condition. If I call this as P1, this as P2. If I assume an isentropic process, I have to draw a vertical line. So if I call this as 1, this as 2 dash. Okay. If it's an actual process, the actual process will be something like this. It is because entropy is rising. This is my actual process 2. At any given point, if I draw an horizontal line on HS diagram or a Mollier diagram, I'll be getting the corresponding value of the enthalpy. So this will give my h2 dash. This will give my h2, and so I can get the corresponding. So this is your h1, h2, and h2 dash. So entropy is constant along 1 to 2 dash, and at 2, between 2 dash, between 1 and 2, it is actually entropy is increasing. So if I assume an isentropic expansion, okay, assuming isentropic expansion, okay, why I'm drawing this HS diagram is you should use Mollier diagram. So please use your Mollier diagram. Corresponding to pressure P1, corresponding to pressure P1 and dry saturated condition, wherever it is, you go and check for this value from your Mollier diagram. Okay, then you have your corresponding, maybe the enthalpy at 2 dash, which is an isentropic expansion at 2 dash. So the what is the enthalpy drop? Enthalpy drop, that is called as delta H, is equal to H1 minus H2 dash. Okay. What I want is, I want you people to look into this value. Okay. I'll give their values. I'll give the, what is the difference I'm going to give. I want you people to cross-check H1. It may be nearest value. Yeah, what is the value of H1? I want you people to do. You take it this as after the class, just open your Mollier diagram or steam tables, whatever you have. Check for the value of H1. Check for the value of H2 dash. So, I'll give the value. It is 380, roughly around 380 kilojoules per kg. Okay, delta H. And hope you remember in your applied thermodynamics, in the nozzles chapter, the velocity, exit velocity is given by this formula. Velocity of the steam V1 is equal to 44.72. This comes from your HFEE. You might have solved this. Divided by, multiplied by root of H. So this is 44.72 into 380 into 10 to the power of 3. I have to convert from kilojoules to joules. If I do that, I'll be getting my velocity as 876 meters per second. See, in the previous problem, V1 was given. Okay, as already you know the understanding of the nozzles, all those things, and you studied applied thermodynamics, how to refer to Mollier chart. This is one typical problem where you are supposed to calculate the V1 based on the enthalpy drop. Okay. So for a no friction condition. So let's go for a no friction condition. VR1 is equal to VR2. This is one assumption. If you want, you can make it. This assumption, what I'm making in this problem, they are not given. Or you can make one more assumption, assuming that friction is losses are 5% or 10%, so standard value. Then your CB or KB is equal to 0.9. Okay. Now, let us draw the velocity triangle for this condition. Let us draw the velocity triangle. Before you could draw the velocity triangle, let's go with it actually. So let's go with velocity triangle, whatever we have drawn. So this is my U, okay. The same thing. This is my alpha 1. This is my VR1. Close it. With your VF1, and this is my VW1. Okay, then we have your VR2, and we have your V2, and you close it. PW2, PF2 and VW2. I got this. This is my velocity triangle. This is alpha 2. We'll just put a rough sketch. Then if any modifications are there, maybe whether VW1 or VW2 are in same direction or opposite direction, we will cross check. If suppose both are in the same direction, then the formula for your work done will be VW1 minus VW2. If both are in a different direction, then we have to just test, we'll put a velocity triangle. This is a rough estimate we have put. Okay. Now from the inlet velocity triangle. From the inlet velocity triangle, what is it actually? Cos alpha 1 is equal to VW1 divided by V1, or my VW1 is equal to V1 cos alpha 1 876 into cos 20. This is around 823 meters per second. So similarly, I can find your VF1. So VF1 is equal to sine alpha 1 is equal to VF1 divided by your V1, or your VF1 is equal to V1 sine alpha 1, or 876 into sine 20. So if I do that, I will be getting around 299.61 meters per second. This is my VF1. Okay. What is my tan beta 1? It's a very simple problem. Tan beta 1 is equal to VF1 divided by, what do we have actually? VW1 minus VW2. That's all. VW1 minus U. Not U, it is VW1 minus U. Okay. So it is VF1 divided by X, or beta 1 is equal to tan inverse of VF1 divided by VW1 minus U, or beta 1 is equal to tan inverse of VF1 is 299.61 divided by VW1 is equal to 823 minus 450. If I do, I am getting my beta 1 is equal to roughly around 38.77. I can take it as 39 degrees. And also, they are given both are equiangular. So, beta 1 and beta 2 both are same. That's all. Whatever they have asked in the problem statement is solved. They have asked us to solve only beta 1. So, why I have taken this particular problem is, I want to, here, in this problem, the thing is, we have to go to Mollier chart. Mollier chart and try to calculate this velocity. Here also they can complicate it. If the expansion is actual, if they give that expansion, the hydraulic efficiency or the vane efficiency, whatever it is, if it is 0.9%, here this delta H you have to multiply by 0.9, or you have to get that also. So the efficiency comes into picture. This being an ideal condition, so I am getting my velocity is around 876. So this particular problem, why I am trying to solve this particular thing is, go back and look into your nozzles, what you have studied in your applied thermodynamics, and try to where you are supposed to find the velocities. So that is the velocity of the steam, and that V1, how you to calculate, to get an understanding of that, I have taken this particular problem. So in this problem, suppose if they ask you, find the work done, power developed, so we have to find the power developed. How to find the power developed? See, beta 1 and beta 2 is found actually. How to calculate if the throat area of the nozzle is 0.24 meter square, find the power developed by the turbine. Okay. To do this, what we are supposed to do? The area they are given. So area is 0.24 meter square. What is my mass flow rate? Mass flow rate is equal to rho into ये इंटू वी एफ और वी. ओके सो नाउ व्हाट इज द डेंसिटी ऑफ द स्टीम, हाउ टू गेट द डेंसिटी ऑफ द स्टीम, हाउ टू गेट द डेंसिटी ऑफ द स्टीम. सो यू गो टू योर स्टीम टेबल्स, यू गो टू योर स्टीम टेबल्स एंड करस्पॉन्डिंग टू योर पी वन, एट पी वन इज इक्वल टू 10 bar, what you will find is actually you will find the specific volume. Okay, you might be having some kind of steam tables in applied thermodynamics, either from the Kurmi or from the ASME steam tables and all. That will be there. Just refer to that steam tables at a pressure of 1 bar. Sorry, a pressure of 10 bar, no? Yeah, at the pressure of 10 bar, note down what is the corresponding specific volume. Okay, the specific volume corresponding to dry saturated steam at 10 bar is found to be, okay, 38.423. That is 53 cube for the same. Let me get that value one by 2. It is 38.10 bar, it is 0.018034. Okay, 0.0 = 10 bar. Okay, it is 0.19435. 0.19435. I have ASME steam table from that corresponding to 10 bar or 1 megapascals. We have, this is V1 is equal to VG, that is your dry saturated steam is equal to 0.19435 meter cube per kg. And what is your saturation temperature? You can just check it. These are some of the things what I told, no? You can check those saturation temperatures. What will be your enthalpy? So H1, just I told around, I took the difference of it. It is around 2700 some change, 2800. Rather referring to your Mollier chart, you can get it from the steam tables. Or from the Mollier chart itself, you can get this value. You have the specific volume lines, you can see that. So from the specific volume lines, if you look into that, so this 10 bar and 0.2 meter cube. So 0.19 means 0.2 roughly. If you are using the Mollier chart, your V1 from Mollier chart will be roughly around 0.2 meter cube per kg. Okay. Now, what will be the density? Just take the ratio of that 0.2. So, 1 upon 0.2, we know that your density is equal to 1 upon V1. Okay. So, it is 1 upon 0.19435. If I do that, I am getting around 5.14 or 15 kg per meter cube. Okay. Now, mass flow rate is equal to, density is 5.15 into area is 0.24 meters per second. And we calculate the VF, which is 299.61. So, this will be your mass flow rate. It is 369.98 kg per second. It's a very large, so good amount of mass flow rate. Now, what is the power developed actually? The power developed is equal to mass flow rate into work done per unit mass. What is work done per unit mass? W by M is equal to, okay, VW1 minus VW2 into U. Okay, so we found VW1. How to find VW2? So as beta1 is equal to beta2, VR1 is equal to VR2, I found it. I have to find from your corresponding, see, once I find VR2, and beta 2 I know, I can find VF1. So VF2 I know, VR2 I know. Okay, once I found VF2, see what is my VF2? Your VF2 is equal to VW2 sine alpha 2. Fine. So I don't know the, see, VF2 is equal to V2. So V2 sine alpha 2. VF2 is equal to V2 sine alpha 2. I don't know the value of V2. I don't know the value of this thing. But I know the value of VF1 because VF1 is equal to VF2. Then I VW2 plus U. See, if I take sine beta 2 or tan beta 2, if I take tan beta 2 is equal to VF2 divided by VW2 plus U. I know the value of beta 1. I know the value of beta because beta 1 is equal to beta 2. I know the value of beta 2. I know the value of U. I can find VW2. Fine. If I use this particular formula, I need to find V2. From V2, I can find VW2. It is two steps actually. Either you can find V2 and then you can find alpha 2, all those things if they required. But in this case, only I need VW2. So what I'll be using is, I'll taking the from the exit velocity triangle, from the exit velocity triangle, tan theta 2 is equal to VF2 divided by VW2 plus U. So tan beta 2 is how much? It's the same, beta 1 and beta 2 both are same. Okay, tan beta 2 is equal to 38.77 tan 38.77 is equal to VF1 is equal to VF2. VF1 is 299.61 divided by VW2 plus your U is 450 meters per second is given in the problem. Yes, U is equal to 450 meters per second. Okay, now what is VW2? I need to find it. So VW2 plus 450 is equal to is equal to 299.61 divided by tan 38.77, or VW2 is equal to this minus 299.61 divided by tan 38.77. Okay, minus 450. If I do that, I am getting around 299 divided by tan 38.77 is 72 minus 50. It is minus 77.72 meters per second. That means I have assumed both are in opposite direction. Are you getting? I have assumed both are in opposite direction. But what has been found from this particular thing? See, now in the velocity diagram, I have put VW1 is in this direction, VW2 is in this direction. This is just a rough sketch I have put. Now, what is showing? This is in opposite direction. That means that the VW2 is in this direction. Okay, that means both are in the same direction. So now, what I need to put for your work done per unit this thing? So it will be VW1 minus this thing. So VW1 is how much? It is 823. VW1 is 823 minus 77.72 into 450. Okay. 823 minus 77.72 into 450. If I do that, I am getting around 335.37. 335.37. 7 किलो जूल्स, किलो जूल्स पर केजी. ओके, दिस इज पर यूनिट मास. ओके, नाउ व्हाट इज द पावर डेवलप्ड एक्चुअली इज इक्वल टू मास फ्लो रेट इनटू डब्ल्यू बाय एम. इफ आई डू दैट आई एम गेटिंग मास फ्लो रेट इज 369.98 इंटू 335.37. 369.98, if I do, I am getting around 12.4 megawatts. 12.4 megawatts are 12,402, to be very precise, 12,402 kilowatts. This is the power developed. Okay, this is one way of finding your power. Say this is a very lengthy problem where you are supposed to use your Mollier diagram to calculate the corresponding enthalpies. See, at 10 bar if you take and see what is the corresponding H1 and H2, you can get it from the steam tables. Or I prefer you people use the Mollier diagram and calculate this H1 and H2. And from that, calculate the velocity. If this is not the kind of problem, they would have given directly the velocity of the steam entering your turbine is at some velocity, 800 meters per second or 400 meters per second, they would have given it. This is one way of calculating the V1 from your steam tables or from your Mollier diagram. So instead of Mollier diagram, you can use steam tables also, where you can get H1 and H2 dash from your steam tables. To get that H2 dash actually, you need to say, why I'm not asking you people to go to the steam tables is, you have to calculate see, this is in the wet condition. You have to find the dryness fraction, equate the entropies, find S1 and find S2 dash. So entropy at 1 is equal to entropy at 2. S1 you will be getting at the dry saturation at a 10 bar. Equate it to S2. You might have done all those things in your applied thermodynamics. Find the value of X at 1 bar, take the value of HF plus X into HFG. Then you will get the H2 dash. If you go by steam tables. Otherwise, if you go directly the Mollier diagram, you will be getting the H1 directly, draw an horizontal line. H2 draw an horizontal line, you will get it. Okay. This is about solving this problem using Mollier diagram to calculate V1, and rest of the procedure is the same. Just I use a simple velocity triangle. The same problem can be solved using graphical method also. The previous thing, whatever we did, no, the graphical method, they assume, take U1 is equal to some X is equal to some 30 meters per second or something. Or that's a scale, and to the scale you draw the velocity diagram and you will be getting it. See, one advantage of going for graphical method is, you will be getting the directions, everything automatically. You need not worry, because everything you are drawing to the point scale, because they all are vectors. See, all the things, there are vectors, they have a certain magnitude and they have the direction. So the direction is given, magnitude is there, and you have the alpha, all the things, maybe little bit here and there, to the very approximate you may get it. Instead of getting 32.33, you may get 32. So that's the only small difference you may get. So I prefer you people go with graphical method. Try to practice both. Okay. We'll try to solve one multi-stage problem. Okay. A two-stage problem. And then I think that should be enough for you to close this steam turbine. Draw the velocity triangle for a stage in impulse turbine with two rings of moving blades for the following parameters. Nozzle angle is 15 degrees, moving blade tip discharge angle is 30 degrees, fixed blade discharge angle is 20 degrees, the final discharge is axial. Friction loss per blade is 10% of relative velocity. Okay, it occurs both on the fixed and moving blades. Find the blade velocity for nozzle stream exit velocity of 500 meters per second and the diagram efficiency of the states. Take speed ratio as, I think we missed out, take speed ratio as 0.45. Take speed ratio as 0.45 for this particular problem. I think that was a typo error, I missed out. Okay, let's try to find the solution for this. Let's write the what is given data. The given is the alpha 1, that is the first ring, that is what is entering is 15 degrees. Okay, then the blade angle beta 1, sorry, it's a blade exit angle, fixed blade discharge angle, that is beta 2. It is 30 degrees. Okay, now this being an impulse machine, your beta 1 is equal to beta 2 because of the impulse turbine. Okay, this is for the first row of the blades, first two rings. This is for the first row of the blades. Now we will come to the second row. See, alpha 1, alpha 2. See, I am going to use 1 and 2 for the first row, 3 and 4 for the second row. Alpha 3 is 20. See, the fixed blade discharge angle is. So what will happen? It's going to discharge that particular thing from the, you have, see, we have the first rotor, then you have the blade. So from the blade, the fluid is entering the second rotor at an angle of 20 degrees. That is the meaning of it. Okay. That is alpha 3 is equal to 20 degrees. And then it is, the final discharge is axial. That is your alpha 4 is 90 degrees. Okay. Then the friction coefficient is 10% of the relative velocity. That is, if it is 10%, 1 minus 0.1 is 0.1. So 1 minus 0.1 is actually, it is 0.9. That is your KB or CB is equal to 0.9. And they are given V1 is equal to 500 meters per second. 500 meters per second. And phi is equal to 0.45. This is for your second row. So V1 is for the first row. Okay. V1, let me write the V1 is there. There are some common. So this is for common. All the things are common. This is for the second row. And what are the common things? Your alpha, see, your CB is equal to 0.9, which is common. V1 is for the first row, which is 500 meters per second. And they are given phi is equal to 0.4. What we are supposed to find? To find the blade velocity for the nozzles, that is U. Blade velocity is nothing but U. To find U, and we are supposed to find the vane efficiency or blade efficiency or hydraulic efficiency. Okay. Now you can solve this problem using graphical method or this. If I go with graphical methods or your regular trigonometric principles, you ought to end up with a similar kind of an answer. Okay. But how the velocity triangle will look like? Let me try. Let us try with a graphical method. Okay. If I use that graphical method, this is how it looks like. So let me take a scale. Let us take a scale of 1 centimeter is equal to, same thing, 50 meters per second. The first stage, see, for the first stage, what is the value of U? I don't know the value of U. How to find the U? I know phi is equal to U by V1, or your U is equal to phi into V1. So V1, they are given it as 500. So 0.45 into 500. So 0.45 into 500, if I do, it is around 225 meters per second. U is equal to 225 meters per second. Okay. Now what I will do, I will just go, 225 means it's around 4.5 centimeters. 4.5 centimeters, I will take the scale from this particular point. It is 1, 2, 3, 4, 4.5. So this is the u. So u was equal to 4.5 centimeters because of 225. Now I know the value of alpha 1. Alpha 1 is how much? They've given it as 15 degrees. So if I call this point as A and this as B, from the point A, 500 means 500 divided by 50 means 10 centimeters. So from point A with alpha 1 is equal to 15 degrees, I will take 10 centimeters. Fine, I'll take 10 centimeters. Yeah. So this is my 10 centimeters. 10 centimeters if I will take and draw the line. I'll be getting this line. Okay. Once I get this line, what I will do, I'll call that point as C. So this is my V1 and this is my alpha. Join B and C. Join B and C. This will give my VR1. Join the horizontal line here and vertical line here. So you call this as D. So this gives your VF1 and you measure this, this will give you VW1 and you measure this angle beta 1. Okay, you measure that angle, that beta 1, you will be getting it as 30 degrees. You will get, if you do it properly, you will be getting it because of the impulse. Maybe here and there, if maybe 29 point some change you may get. Now they are given beta 2 as 30 degrees. So with B as the point, and what is the value of VR2? VR2, see, you get measure the value BC. So BC may be around 5 centimeters. See, your VR1 may be of around 5 centimeters roughly. I want you people to do this on the graph sheet. I want you people to do this and upload. Okay, check this. I'll just teach you the method how to solve this. Okay. BC you measure, you will get VR1. What is VR2? It is 0.9 times of your 5 centimeters. 0.9 times of, okay, if I do that, I'll be getting that as around 225 meters per second. So VR1 and VR2, so that will be 2. So that will be a 4.5 centimeters or so. What I will do actually, I will from point B, I will draw the 4.5 centimeters like this. So somewhere here I'll get. Around. This is my VR2. You have to cross check, that's it. This gives my beta 2. You join this, you will be getting your V2. Okay, you call this as ABCD. This you call it as E. And you join, draw an horizontal line and draw a vertical line. So this is your VF2. So with practice this will come, this will become easy for you. The more you practice, drawing velocity triangles will become very easy. So E and this is F. This is for the first row of the blade. See, why I'm telling you people to draw, use the graphical method is all the values are in terms of scale because they're all vectors. They have a magnitude, you know the directions. Fine. You measure this, this will be your alpha. So from every point, you would just take the measure. I want the value of V1, measure that, multiply by 50. You want VF1, measure that, multiply by 50. You measure VW2, multiply by 50. And the one advantage of going for graphical method is, you will be getting with directions properly. All the directions will be very clear for you if you go for graphical method. This is for the first. Now, how to go for the second row? This is for the first row. How to go for the second row? To do that, actually, what you are supposed to do, see, my blade speed remains the same. So what you do, you draw a vertical line, thin line from here. Okay, you draw a a thin vertical line from here, from A and B, draw the thin vertical line. Draw the thin vertical line. Okay. Then you take the same blade velocity u. Take the same blade velocity, because first row or second row, the blade velocity or your peripheral velocity will be the same. Fine. EF, you call this as G, you call this as H. Okay. Now, they are told that alpha 3 is 20 degrees, alpha 4 is 90 degrees. Okay. Now, with alpha 3, with point G, with 20 degrees, what is the value of V3? Okay. Now, your friction coefficient is something like this. It is VCB is equal to, your CB is equal to VR2 by VR1. Also, there is a nozzle. In the nozzle, it will be like this. So, the friction is there not only in your rotor, when it is entering your exiting or entering your nozzle also, it is there. Not only in the rotor. So, V3 by V2. V3 by V2. Then what is your V3? V3 is equal to CB into your V2. Suppose we get the value of V2. So V2, suppose you get it as around 200 meters per second from the scale. It may be around 3 centimeters or 4 centimeters. 3 to 4 centimeters you may get. 152, 200 meters per second you will get it. So V2 multiply by 0.10, if I do, I'll get the value of V3. Okay. Now, with V3 and alpha is equal to 20 degrees, you draw a line like this. You draw a line. I'm just drawing a rough sketch, that's it. If you draw to the scale, you will get the exact dimension. This is my V3. This is my alpha 3. And you call G, H, I. Don't use I, you use that G. Okay. Now, join H to J. Join H to J. You will get your VR3. You close the triangle. This will give your VF3. This will give your VW3. That is from G H I J K. Let me call this as K. So K to G, if you measure, you will get your VW3. Okay. Now, you know this beta 3. See, one more thing they are given. They are given that it is radial. Your VF2 and V2. So VW3, that means that your VW4 is 0 because it's axially it's going out. So you draw a vertical line from here. From G, you draw a vertical line. Okay. Now, VR3. What is VR4? VR4 by VR3. Okay, VR4 by VR3. See, if you draw to the scale, you'll get it. Don't worry, but I'm drawing a little bit bigger and all. Don't worry. So methodology, you learn the methodology. Now VR3 is around 3 centimeters or 4 centimeters, you may get it. So VR4 is 0.9 times of that particular thing. And beta 3 is equal to beta. So they are given the angle of your beta 3 is equal to beta 4. Because this is also an impulse machine. Beta 3 is equal to beta 4. It's an impulse machine. So with that, you take your compass with that VR3 and cut it here. Wherever it cuts, you join that. Wherever it's going to cut, no, you join that. You take from H, you take that VR4, whatever the dimension, you cut that, you'll be getting that particular point. So this is your point L. And this is your VR4, and your alpha 4 is 90 degrees, your V4 is equal to PF4 because your VW4 is equal to 0. I got my second row velocity triangle. Don't worry, we have three stages also. We have in steam turbines, when you do compounding, we will be having a three stages or we'll be having four stages. So that's an advanced steam turbine course. We will go for three stages and four stages. So that's the time consuming. I think for you, for undergraduate course, for your turbo machine, this thing, just go with two stages. That's more than enough. Fine. For all those things, so I will give a rough value what you may get. So you may get around VR1 around 250 meters per second. I'm just giving the rough values. You just cross check this particular. So this is the methodology. So VR1 around 250 meters per second. And VR2, so around just 0.9 times of it is around 235 meters per second. And you'll be getting around VF2 around 200 meters per second. Not a cross check. And VW2 is around minus 130. You will get you around 130 meters per second. That is minus means it will come in opposite direction. You will be getting in opposite direction. You have to cross check. That's it. Then your alpha, your V2 around 240 meters per second. V2 is around 240 meters per second. You will be getting it. And your V3, 0.9 times of it, around 215 meters per second, you'll be getting it. And beta 3 is equal to VR4. So now, once you calculate all those things, VW3 you are supposed to find. Okay, VW3 is roughly around, you'll be getting around 140 meters per second or something. Just cross check around. Around 300. VW4 is 0. VW3, yeah. VW3 is around 300 some meters per second. Anyway, VW4 is equal to 0. How to calculate the power developed? Actually, you are supposed to find a blade efficiency. To do that, we need work done. Work done is given by VW1. Minus VW2 plus, this is for the first row, VW3 minus VW4. This is for the first row. This is for the second row. Work done multiplied by U. So what is your vane efficiency or blade efficiency? This is equal to work done by your kinetic energy square. That is V1 square by 2. Okay, V1. So you calculate W and you divide it by V1 square by 2. You will get the corresponding. Well, I want you people to solve this and substitute these numbers and try to get this. If I tell the numbers, you try to match that numbers. Roughly, I have given them some numbers, V1, how much it will be. I want you people to try, because when you try only, you will come to know. I write something over here. So I'm teaching you the method how to solve this numerical. So we have solved three methods. Almost all the numericals will be of similar kinds. You have to draw the velocity triangle and get the solution for it. So with this, we have come to the end of your steam turbine.